very warm welcome to you all, and especially it is a privilege to be able to welcome this morning the Deputy Lieutenant of Shropshire, Mr. Trevor-Jones, and the Mayor, Hurst-Knight. It's a solemn occasion when we gather together in this season of Easter, but to remember also as part of our national mourning, his life and work, and We ask that in due time we may share with your servant Philip that clear vision, promised to us in the same Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen. Stand with us. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to God. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I said to you, that you have seen me and yet do not believe. Everything that the Father gives me will come to me. And anyone who comes to me, I will never drive away, for I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but to
the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And we know that the Duke of Edinburgh was a Christian. I think yesterday the BBC didn't really win any prizes for ecumenical understanding when a newsreader who was interviewing the Sikh mentioned that Prince Philip was baptised Greek Orthodox, but then, he said, he decided to be a Christian. So, Prince Philip was a Christian. Today is the second Sunday of Easter. We're celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so, what I'm going to say is based more on the official reading for today rather than the readings you've heard. And if you have a copy of the pew sheet, you'll see there the reading from John chapter 20, which is what I should be focusing on. Of the various recollections I've heard about Prince Philip in the last couple of days, one of the most interesting ones to me were the recollections of both the Archbishop of Canterbury and the former Archbishop of York, John Sentinel, that whenever they preached at services where Prince Philip was in the congregation, he would afterwards ask them the most searching questions about their sermons, often leading to quite deep discussions. So Prince Philip was a prime example of what an earlier Archbishop of Canterbury, St. Anselm, called faith-seeking understanding. We believe, and so we ask questions in order to deepen our understanding of what we believe. And Thomas was a prime example. Thomas gets a bad press in some places as doubting Thomas. But that seems a bit unfair. Why do we always hear about doubting Thomas when we never hear about denying Peter? On the other hand, there are others who seem to think that it's a virtue not to accept the basic doctrines of Christianity. And for them, doubting Thomas is a hero. But the point about Thomas is not that he doubted, but that through his experience, he came to a more advanced understanding than anyone else. His problem is basically that he missed the risen Christ's first appearance of his disciples. The other disciples didn't understand the resurrection at first either, but they had a head start on Thomas because they were there when Jesus first appeared. The point about Thomas isn't that he doubted, but thanks to his experiences, thanks to his questions being answered, he became Hughes as he sends us out, as he was sent by the Father, to share the gospel so that those who believe may receive forgiveness, while those who refuse to believe remain in their sins. The Christian gospel isn't always popular. If we're followers of Christ, we're not going to be universally popular. But it makes me afraid. I'm sure that makes you afraid as well. But the risen Christ isn't constrained by our fears. He breathes on his disciples his pneuma, a word that means both breath and spirit. A visible, tangible promise of what's going to come upon them, or rather, who's going to come upon them. After Jesus' ascension, the Holy Spirit to equip them as they're sent out. We may well be afraid, but the victor of all that can oppose us is not constrained by our fears. He's breathed on us his breath, his spirit, to equip us for the task to which he's called us, to breathe into us his risen life that's not constrained by death. The reason why we can be confident that our death is not the end, that we've not said goodbye to Prince Philip forever. Let's focus on Jesus, not on the world. He's overcome even death. Prince Philip is even now discovering that for himself. Let us live in that faith. Amen.
right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places to give you thanks and praise. Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now we give you thanks because through him you have given us the hope of the glorious resurrection, so that although death comes to us all, yet we rejoice in the promise of eternal life. For to your faithful people life is changed, not taken away. And when our mortal flesh is laid aside, an everlasting dwelling place is made ready for us in heaven. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. All glory be to you, our heavenly Father, who in your tender mercy gave your only Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his well oblation of himself God's offering full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. He instituted, and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue with perpetual memory of that his precious death until he comes again. Hear us, merciful Father, we humbly pray. Grant that, by the power of your Holy Spirit, we, receiving these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine, according to your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread, and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, gave you thanks, gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Praise to you, Lord Jesus, dying, you destroyed our death, rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Therefore, Lord and Heavenly Father, in remembrance of the precious death and passion, the mighty resurrection and glorious ascension of your Son, Jesus Christ, we offer you through him this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Grant that by merits, his merits in heaven, and through faith in his blood, we and all your church may receive forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. Although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer you any sacrifice, yet we pray that you accept this, the duty and service that we owe. Do not weigh our merits, but pardon our offenses, and fill and drink this cup. We proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to suffer. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Through the choir chair.